بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. في البداية أود الترحيب بالحضور والحرص على المشاركة في برنامجنا، والذي يناقش موضوع هام يثير جدل عالميا ومحليا، والخاص بإعادة معالجة الأدوات أحادية الاستخدام. هيكون معنا النهاردة إن شاء الله محاضرين متميزين: دكتور عبد الرحمن كمال، دكتور نضال تشقندي، أستاذة أحلام العمري. هيتم خلال البرنامج طرح الموضوعات التالية: تاريخ استخدام الأدوات أحادية الاستخدام والمخاطر التي تتعلق بإعادة معالجتها أو إعادة استخدامها، عرض التوصيات والتنظيمات العالمية الخاصة بإعادة معالجة الآلات أحادية الاستخدام، التوصيات على المستوى الوطني، والتحديات التي تعوق إعادة معالجة الآلات أحادية الاستخدام في الوقت الحالي. هيتم إن شاء الله بنهاية اليوم الإجابة على أي تساؤلات أو استفسارات، أي أسئلة يرجى الكتابة في الشات. أأمل من الجميع الحرص على تسجيل الدخول للبرنامج من خلال الكيو آر كود ده، وهيتم عرضه مرة ثانية إن شاء الله في فترة البريك. أتمنى لكم يوم علمي موفق بإذن الله. في الفيرست سيشن في الجلسة الأولى هيتم فيه عرض محاضرتين: Overview of Single Use Item Negative Consequence of Reprocessing مع الدكتور عبد الرحمن كمال. Second lecture, International Regulation Regarding Reprocessing of Single-Use Device, Dr. Nidal Tashkandi. هيكون معنا break for 15 minutes. After the break, there will be National Regulation Regarding Prohibiting a Reprocessing of Single-Use Device with Ms. Ahlam Al-Omari. And then we'll be open discussion for 40 minutes, and then course evaluation and closing, inshallah, by 11:30. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome everyone. I would like to thank you for your participation in our program, which discuss an important topic with international and national controversy: reuse of single-use device. Today we will discuss important topic including history of use of single-use device, possible risk associated with reprocessing or reusing, overview of international recommendation and regulation regarding reuse of single-use device, national recommendation for prohibiting reuse of single-use device. The speaker today, Dr. Abdurrahman Kamal, Dr. Nidal Tashkandi, Ms. Ahlam Al-Omari, welcome all. There will be a chance for answering your question by the end of the day. So please, if you have any question or comment, please write in the chat. Everyone should register for the program through the QR code, and I wish you a good scientific day. First topic today with Dr. Abdurrahman Kamal, overview of single-use device, negative consequence of reprocessing. Dr. Abdurrahman Kamal is a senior registrar in infection control, PhD in medical microbiology and immunology, Egyptian fellowship in infection prevention and control, CIC certified 2021. Welcome, Dr. Abdurrahman Kamal. Now you can share your presentation. Fadal, Dr. Abdurrahman. دكتور عبد الرحمن. واضح دكتور عبد الرحمن، اتفضل.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. نأسف على التأخير، بس هحط له فن. أشكر دكتور حمان وكل الزملاء بالإدارة العامة على مجهودهم المشكور دائما في دعم مثل هذه البرامج التي تدعم برنامج مكافحة العدوى وتطبيقه. واليوم بإذن الله هيتم عرض أحد المواضيع اللي عليها خلاف كبير جدا على مستوى العالم كله، ويحتاج إلى أن نراه بشكل دقيق حتى يتم تطبيقه وتجنب التطبيق الخاطئ له في مستشفياتنا بالمملكة العربية السعودية. وقبل أن أبدأ في شرح الموضوع نفسه وتفاصيله، أحب أوضح نقطة يمكن الكثير من الزملاء العاملين في المجال الصحي قد تغيب عنهم هذه النقطة. دائما ينظر الممارسين الصحيين للمرضى بهدف تقديم الخدمة. كيف سأقدم الخدمة للمريض؟ يعني على سبيل المثال، لو أنا عندي مريض يحتاج إلى عملية دقيقة، هنفترض مثلا زراعة النخاع، في هذه الحالة كل الأطباء والممارسين والمساعدين والتمريض هدفه هو إجراء هذه العملية ونجاحها، وقد يغيب عنه النقطة الهامة وهو إجراء هذه العملية أو هذه البروسيجر أندر أمبريلا أوف بيشنت سيفتي، تحت مظلة حماية المريض. فقد تنجح العملية ولكن تحدث مضاعفات تؤدي إلى وفاة المريض بسبب عدم مراعاة البيشنت سيفتي أو حماية المريض أثناء هذا الإجراء، برغم أنه تم على أحسن وجه ولكن فقد بعض النقاط والسرعة في التنفيذ والمحاولة لتقديم الخدمة دون النظر لحماية المريض بشكل دقيق قد يؤدي إلى هذا العرض المهم أو يؤدي إلى وفاة المريض لا قدر الله. اليوم هنعرض مثال مهم جدا لمثل هذه الممارسة التي يتعامل بها معظم الممارسين الصحيين. By English, good morning. And I'm happy for meeting with all participants. Today we will discuss a very important issue related to the reuse of single use. And before starting, I need to explain very important point. Some healthcare worker happy when present the surface to the patient and forget the umbrella of patient safety during present or give the surface for the patient. For example, if I have one patient need very sophisticated operation, I am try to rapid preparation to make this operation and to success the operation. And sometime I forget the patient safety. And that maybe cause the complication, maybe arrive to death of the patient. Today, the reuse of single use one of mistake may cause the harm or adverse event to the patient during service. Okay, next دكتورة حنان. دية العناوين الرئيسية إن شاء الله اللي هيتم مناقشتها خلال العرض الخاص بهذا الموضوع. هناخد مقدمة وتاريخ الآلات single use وكيف تم تطور الموضوع، وبعدين التعريف الآلات ذات الاستخدام الواحد وبعض التعريفات المتعلقة بهذا الأمر، وبعدين هناخد تقسيمة العالم سبولدينج في عملية إعادة معالجة الآلات وأنواع الآلات وخطورة نقلها للعدوى. ومع هذا الموضوع هنشرح جزء بسيط خاص ببعض المواد الكيميائية التي تستخدم في عملية التطهير والتعقيم، وبعدها نتطرق إلى نقطة خاصة بتركيب الآلات ومدى تعقد تركيب هذه الآلات سنجل يوز المستخدمة لمرة واحدة، والآخر نقطة هنتكلم فيها المشاكل التي ستقابلنا والمعوقات التي تمنع استخدام أو إعادة استخدام الآلات أحادية الاستخدام. Next دكتور، This is the main aspect today. The first point regarding the history of the single-use item. Before the 1970, most medical devices were considered reusable because it is a rubber or glass or metal, and usually after used, cleaned by the water, cleaned by cleaning solution, and wiped down, then reuse again. During this period, very many complication like the transmission of respiratory infection from one patient to another and bloodstream infection like hepatitis B and hepatitis C, because the this instrument reusable without adequate reprocessing. قبل 1970 معظم الآلات الطبية المستخدمة زي ما واضح في الصورة أمامكم كانت آلات مصنعة من الإزاز والمعدن والبلاستيك، وكان يعاد استخدامها مرة أخرى بعد تنظيفها بمادة أو ببعض المياه ومسحها بقطن أو شاش، ويرجع ويعاد استخدامها مرة أخرى لمريض آخر. ولكن لوحظ في هذه الفترة انتشار عدد كبير من الأمراض، من ضمنها أمراض الجهاز التنفسي زي الدرن الرئوي وزي الإنفلونزا، وأمراض التي تنتقل عن طريق الدم، وخصوصا الهيباتيتس سي والهيباتيتس بي، حتى معروف في بعض الدول النامية يعني انتشر هيباتيتس سي جدا بسبب هذه السرنجات الزجاجية التي يعاد استخدامها مرة أخرى للبيشنت. هذا ما قبل عام 1970. نيكست دكتور حنان. Beginning in 1970, many manufacturers began to produce medical devices designated as a single use due to demand by healthcare organization and complexity of newly designed devices and complexity of many medical procedures. Okay. من بداية 1970 وما بعدها بدأت المصانع تصنع آلات مكتوب عليها أو محددة أنها استخدام واحد، لا تستخدم إلا مرة واحدة. وهذا السبب في ذلك هو كثرة الطلبات المقدمة من قبل المنظمات الصحية المختلفة لهذه الآلات، وتطور وتعقد العمليات المختلفة والإجراءات الطبية المختلفة للمرضى. نكس دكتور حنان. And start the term of sterility. The term of sterility is essential to prevent the harm associated with the use of many medical devices. And during the start of sterility, some machine used for sterility of single-use device like the ethylene oxide and the gamma electron radiation. This machine, after some time, the adverse event regarding the use of an instrument, single-use instrument, which is sterilized by this machine, and also adverse event related to the use of this sterilized machine, like the ethylene oxide machine, have many eye complication and sore throat and also carcinogenic and explosive. And now most of country prevent the use of ethylene oxide. Okay. And also in this period, the medical devices continue to become more complexity and more engineering design complex started to production of single use device. في هذه الفترة من بعد 1970 ظهر كلمة تعقيم الآلات بصفة عامة، سواء أحادية الاستخدام أو التي يعاد استخدامها مرة أخرى. وكان يستخدم في هذه الفترة بعض أجهزة التعقيم التي تحتوي على مواد زي الإيثيلين أوكسيد، وبعض الإشعاعات زي أشعة جاما وبعض الإشعاعات الإلكترونية. وكانوا يستخدمون هذه المعدات في تعقيم الآلات أحادية الاستخدام في هذه الفترة. ظهر مشكلتين. المشكلة الأولى اللي ظهرت هو أن استخدام الآلات أحادية الاستخدام بعد تعقيمها في هذه الأجهزة كان يسبب أعراض جانبية ومشاكل قد تؤدي إلى الوفاة لبعض وفشل بعض العمليات لبعض المرضى. النقطة الثانية الأهم هو أن هذه الأجهزة التي كانت تستخدم في التعقيم ظهر لها أعراض جانبية خطيرة، سواء على الممارسين الصحيين اللي بيعملوا في هذه الأجهزة زي فنيين التعقيم، زملائنا فنيين التعقيم بدأ يظهر عندهم مشاكل، وكذلك المرضى اللي بيستخدموا الآلات، حتى الآلات اللي معاد استخدامها. فتوقف استخدام هذه المعدات وعلى رأسها الإيثيلين أوكسيد، ولم يعد يستخدم في دول كثير جدا من العالم، توقف استخدامه لأنه له أعراض جانبية خطيرة، وهو أصلا جهاز قابل للانفجار، لأن هي مادة قابلة للانفجار وبتعمل مشاكل صحية شديدة جدا في العين والأنف، وكمان تسبب أمراض خطيرة زي أمراض الأورام وغيرها. وفي نفس الفترة اللي حصل فيها هذا التوقف بدأت تتطور الآلات أحادية الاستخدام من حيث التشكيل الهندسي المعقد لها. Next دكتور عنا. Then in 1982 at least two of third of sterile device labeled as a single used only. Okay, then the United States Public Health start to the problem by reusing the hemodialysis filter. Why? Because some manufacturer not labeled the single use or reprocessed instrument, not labeled. So the US take the US public health take a decision for reusing the hemodialysis filter. In the same time, the FDA, the American FDA, start to detect the adverse, some adverse event related to the reuse of this single use instrument, like the transmission of bloodstream infection, like the hepatitis B and hepatitis C and HIV, and start to regulate this issue. And any manufacturer produce medical device must be labeled, this device is single use or reprocessed. في عام 1982 كان حوالي تلتين الآلات الطبية المستخدمة عبارة عن single use device، ولكن بعض الشركات لم تكن تذكر أو تكتب على الآلات الخاصة بها إن هذه الآلات single use أو reprocessed أو reused instrument، يعني مستخدمة لمرة واحدة أو يمكن إعادة استخدامها مرة أخرى. من هنا أخذت منظمة الصحة العامة الأمريكية قرار أحادي بإعادة استخدام الفلتر المستخدم في عملية الغسيل الكلوي، في أجهزة الغسيل الكلوي. بعد فترة بدأت منظمة الغذاء والدواء الأمريكية تلاحظ وتسجل بعض المضاعفات السيئة من إعادة استخدام هذه الآلات، زي انتقال الأمراض التي تنتقل عن طريق الدم، وهي أمراض الهباتيتس بي والسي والإتش آي في. ومن هنا فرضت منظمة الصحة الغذاء والدواء الأمريكية فرضت على كل الشركات التي تنتج آلات طبية أن تسجل على هذه الآلات هل هي مصنعة بشكل يسمح بإعادة استخدامها بعد التطهير والتنظيف والتعقيم أو لا يسمح وتعتبر سينجل يوز. ومن هنا توقفت هذه العملية، وكانت هي دي يمكن الشرارة أو بداية شرارة هذا الموضوع. نيكست دكتور حنان. Next, please. Definition of single-use device. The FDA definition, the single-use device is a device used, intended used for one patient during single procedure. One patient for single procedure. And it is not intended to be reprocessed. Not intended to be reprocessed. يبقى أنا لو عايز أدي تعريف باي أرابيك، لو أنا عايز أدي تعريف للسنجل يوز ديفايس اتفقت عليه منظمة الصحة، منظمة الغذاء والدواء الأمريكية وكل منظمات الغذاء والدواء في العالم على أنها هي الآلات التي تستخدم لمرة واحدة لمريض واحد، ولا يمكن إعادة معالجتها بشكل صحيح واستخدامها لمريض آخر أو لنفس المريض حتى. يبقى إذا تستخدم لمريض واحد مرة واحدة فقط، وده تعريفها الآلات السنجل يوز. نيكست. Other related definition, what is the definition of reusable medical device? According to the FDA, it is a device healthcare provided can reprocess. And please, can adequate reprocess and reuse in multiple patient and multiple procedure. Okay? And the FDA is detect this instrument and classified this instrument. الآلات التي يمكن إعادة استخدامها هي آلات تستخدم مع مريض ومن ثم يعاد معالجتها بشكل صحيح، يعني تنظيف وتطهير أو تعقيم على حسب مستوى الآلة، وده هنعرفه كمان شوية، ومن ثم تستخدم لمريض آخر، ده تعريف reusable instrument. Other definition أو other term related to this issue, third party. What is the definition of third party? The third party is entity that inspect, functionally test, cleans, packages, and sterilized medical device labeled for single use in such manner that their quality, physical character and performance are not significantly affected, and the device remains safe and effective in their appropriate clinical uses. This is the definition of third party. In our setting, we cannot apply the third party, because to can inspect the functionality test and the clean test and the sterilization test, this is need biomedical engineering members and need other specialty, engineering specialty, and need one infection control, infection preventionist specialist, and need one microbiologist for testing about the infection and the intoxin, okay? And need the members from FDA in the country, okay? So in our setting, we cannot prepare the third party. The third party can be prepared by the national FDA and MOH, and can detect the instrument, single-use instrument can be reusable. By Arabic, a third party, أو اللجنة الثالثة, هي عبارة عن كيان مسؤول عن معاينة الآلات وأحادية الاستخدام ووظائفها وطريقة تعقيمها وتطهيرها إذا كنت ناوي تستخدمها مرة أخرى أو حتى في بداية إنتاجها. يعني اللجنة دي ممكن تتابع بداية إنتاج الآلات السنجل يوز، وكذلك إذا قررت أنك تعيد استخدامها. بس أرجوك ركزوا، لأن الحتة دي مهمة جدا. طيب اللجنة دي بتعمل اختبارات لمعاينة الوظائف بتاعة الآلة بعد التعقيم، وقدرتها على نقل العدوى من عدمه، وطريقة تعقيمها بشكل صحيح وتنظيفها بشكل صحيح، وكذلك الوظيفة الكيميائية والميكانيكية بتاعت الآلة نفسها. طيب اللجنة دي عشان تقدر انت تطبقها مثلا في المستشفى عندك، وده طبعا مستحيل، عشان تقدر تعمل لجنة زي دي في المستشفى عندك انت محتاج أعضاء لا يمكن انك انت تقدر تظبطهم في المستشفى عندك. انت محتاج مهندسين من تخصصات مختلفة على رأسها الهندسة الطبية، ومحتاج متخصصين في الميكروبيولوجي، ومحتاج متخصصين في الانفكشن كنترول، خلاص، ومحتاج متخصصين في المواد الكيميائية وتصنيع الآلات، خلاص، عشان يضمنوا مثل هذه العملية. غير انك لازم يكون عندك إجازة من الدولة التي تقوم هذه اللجنة بالعمل فيها لهذا العمل. وبالتالي كل من يتخيل انه يستطيع ان يقيم ثيرد بارتي في المستشفى عنده او في الهيلث كير سيتنج او حتى في التجمع الصحي بتاعه او المديرية، هذا شيء خيالي مستحيل. لابد ان يكون ان تعمل الثيرد بارتي على مستوى ناشونال، وهذا ان شاء الله ممكن يكون هيحدث في المستقبل ان شاء الله في المملكة. اذا الان انت فهمت تعريف الثيرد بارتي وفهمت كيانها، عشان تكون ثيرد بارتي انت محتاج مين؟ طب هل هذا ممكن تطبيقه في الهيلث كير سيتنج؟ لا، انا اقصى حاجه اقدر اعملها في الهيلث كير سيتنج ان الالات اللي مسموح اعاده استخدامها اتاكد ان طريقه الريبروسيسنج صحيحه، طريقه التنظيف والتعقيم والتطهير صحيحه. هذه اقصى شيء اقدر اعمله في الهيلث كير سيتنج بتاعتي. لكن اجيب حد كيميائي عشان يشوف المواد الكيميائيه، واجيب مهندس طبي، واجيب حد من منظمه الغذاء والدواء، هذا لا يمكن، لازم يكون على مستوى الوزاره والدوله. فدي نقطه مهمه جدا عشان بعض الناس فاهم الثيرد بارتي بشكل غلط. طيب تعالوا نتكلم عن موضوع اغلبنا يعرفه في الانفكشن كنترول، سبولدينج كلاسيفيكيشن. سبولدينج كلاسيفيكيشن از ا استراتيجي ديفلوبد باي سبولدينج ساينتست فروم 15 ييرز اجو. This strategy for reprocessing for reusable instrument based on the risk of transmission of infection according the area of the body which touch with this instrument. According this classification, I have critical devices or critical item and semi-critical devices and non-critical devices. The critical device which invade the blood and sterile tissue. Semi-critical, like the endoscope, which contact with the mucous membrane and non-intact skin. Non-critical item, which attach with unbroken skin or intact skin, like stethoscope and cuff of blood pressure instrument. By Arabic, سبولدينج كلاسيفيكيشن، هذا التقسيم اكتشفه عالم من 50 سنة تقريبا، بيقسم الآلات حسب نقطتين، الآلات التي يعاد استخدامها مش السنجل يوز. يبقى السبولدينج كلاسيفيكيشن لا يطبق على السنجل يوز، على الآلات اللي يمكن إعادة استخدامها مرة أخرى. قسم هذه الآلات أكوردنج نقطتين أو متبعا فيها نقطتين، النقطة الأولى قدرتها على نقل العدوى، والنقطة الثانية أو خطورتها في نقل العدوى، والنقطة الثانية الجزء اللي بيتلامس مع هذه الآلة من الجسم. وبالتالي قسمهم إلى 3 أنواع، آلات غير خطرة تماما اللي هو النون كريتيكال ديفايس، زي السماعات اللي بتلمس الجلد الصحيح، الجلد الغير مجروح، نون انتكت سوري انتكت سكين، زي السماعات وزي جهاز الضغط، الكاف بتاعت جهاز الضغط خلاص. وسيمي كريتيكال او شبه خطيره، وشبه الخطيره دي زي المنظار اللي بيلامس الاغشيه المخاطيه خلاص. وكريتيكال ديفايس هي الالات التي تتلامس مع او تخترق الدم والاعضاء المعقمه. نيكست، الصوره اللي بعدها، نيكست بليز. ايوه الصوره دي مهمه جدا. طيب انت قسمت الالات اكوردنج سبولدنج، لا ارجعي ارجعي للصوره تاني بعد اذن الصوره. لا الصوره اللي ايوه اللي قبل دي، تمام. This picture is very important. اللي بعد دي على طول يا دكتور. بس طيب، each instrument critical, semi-critical, non-critical must be reprocessed before reusing again. طيب what is the type of reprocessing? Cleaning, then disinfection. أيوة this picture is big. Cleaning, then disinfection. If the instrument is non-critical, like the stethoscope, like the eye goggle, I can reuse after cleaning and low-level disinfection, or in low-level disinfection like alcohol, like quaternary ammonium compound, okay? But the semi-critical item which touches the mucous membrane, like the endoscope, I cannot reuse without adequate cleaning and disinfection by high-level disinfectant substance. And the sterile instrument, like the metal instrument used in the surgery, this is cannot be reused without cleaning and sterilization. The next question, what is the difference between low level disinfection, high level disinfection, intermediate level disinfection and sterilization? We must understand what is the difference between cleaning, disinfection and sterilization. لازم نفرق تعريف التنظيف والتطهير والتعقيم. التنظيف معناها إزالة الوسخ خلاص، إزالة الوسخ يسمى كليننج أو تنظيف. remove of soiled particle, this is definition of cleaning. disinfection أو التطهير تعريفه قتل الميكروبات الموجودة على الآلة باستثناء البكتيريا السبور أو اللي هي بالعربي بذور البكتيريا او البكتيريا التي تكون حويصلات خلاص. يبقى اذا استخدام مواد كيميائيه لقتل الميكروبات باستثناء البكتيريا المتحوصله هذا يسمى ديس انفكشن بصفه عامه. يبقى ديس انفكشن از ا كيميكال سبستانس ريموف اور كيلينج اول مايكرو اورجانيزم اكسبت بكتيريا السبور. And the sterilization, what is the definition of sterilization? Removal of all or killing of all microorganisms including bacterial spore. هي عملية تقوم بقتل كل الميكروبات شاملة البكتيريا السبور أو بذور البكتيريا. طيب the classification of this infection, the chemical substance used for killing the microorganism is low level, intermediate level and high level. ممكن الصورة اللي بعدها أو اللي بعدها دكتور، أي واحدة فيه. Next. The low level disinfectant kill the vegetative bacteria and enveloped virus or lipid non-lipid virus. Sorry, lipid virus. Enveloped virus like corona virus is lipid virus. Enveloped virus. Okay. and vegetative bacteria like gram positive, gram negative bacteria, all of them can be killed by low level disinfectant like the alcohol, quaternary ammonium compound. Intermediate level disinfectant is a chemical substance kill the vegetative bacteria and enveloped virus and mycobacterium tuberculosis, especially mycobacterium tuberculosis. This is intermediate level. The very important example is chlorine. The high level disinfectant is a chemical substance which kill all of the above and also some resistance bacteria or some spore bacteria. مثالها الـ OBA أو الأورثوفيثالدهايد. أوكي؟ دول الكلاسيفيكيشن بتاع الديسانفكشن كتذكرة بس كده، إحنا عملناها كتذكرة لموضوع الكلاسيفيكيشن أوف انسترومنت أند ديسانفكشن يوزد فور إيتش. طيب، العنوان اللي بعده، بليز. نيكست سلايد بليز. ديزاين كاركترستيك أوف سنجل يوز. أو تركيب الآلات أحادية الاستخدام. طبعًا الآن في الفترة الحالية كل الآلات التي تستخدم لمرة واحدة تصنيعها من حيث الشكل الهندسي ووجود بعض الأماكن الملتوية وبعض الجروفز أو الفراغات تجعلها معقدة جدا في التركيب. طب أنت عايز تقول لنا إيه يعني يا دكتور عبد الرحمن؟ أنت عايز تقول إن الديزاين صعب. طب أنت عايز تقول الديزاين صعب ليه؟ عشان أقول لك إن ديزاين الآلات أحادية الاستخدام عادة لا تسمح بالتنظيف بشكل جيد. طب وايه المشكله لما تبقى مرحله التنظيف ما هي جيده؟ ودي مشكله خطيره عند اغلب الناس. في اغلب الناس متخيلين ان انا لو حطيت الاله في جهاز التعقيم سواء كان البلازما مثلا او جهاز الاستراليزيشن العادي، التعقيم العادي بتاع البخار الستيم، انا هكل الاله هتبقى خلاص كل الميكروبات اللي فيها هتقتل. لا، لو سمحت لابد ان تفهم ان اجهزه التعقيم لا تستطيع قتل الميكروبات اللي في عليها وسخ. يعني إذا كانت الميكروبات مغطاة بوسخ لا يستطيع جهاز التعقيم قتل هذه الميكروبات. عشان كده مرحلة التنظيف أهم وأخطر مرحلة في عملية إعادة الاستخدام أو إعادة التعقيم والتنظيف. وبالتالي لما يبقى عندي الآلات أحادية الاستخدام التركيب الكيميائي بتاعها والتركيب الهندسي بتاعها معقد لا يسمح بالتنظيف بشكل جيد، وبالتالي أجهزة التعقيم اللي هيتم استخدامها في تعقيم هذه الآلات لن تصل إلى الميكروبات بشكل صحيح، وسيظل الوسخ حاجز بين هذه الأجهزة وبين الوصول لقتل الميكروبات. فالنقطة بتاعت الديزاين هنا احنا بنوضحها عشان ناخد بالنا من الفكرة دي، ان بعض الناس عندها فكرة انك كونك استخدمت جهاز التعقيم فأنت خلاص خليت الآلة كده ايا كان نوع الآلة يبقى كده الآلة اصبحت ممتاز. لا، لابد ان تفهم ان التنظيف هو المرحلة المؤدية إلى التعقيم بشكل صحيح. طيب الآلات أحادية الاستخدام يصعب تنظيف عشان التركيب الهندسي بتاعها معقد. طيب ناخد مثال، لو فتحنا الشريحة اللي بعدها بعد إذنك سيد عبد الله، الشريحة اللي بعدها شوفوا المنظر ده كده. الآلة ديت دي آلة، دي الآلة وهي جديدة لم تستخدم في الـ في الـ في الإيه، لم تستخدم قبل كده. شوف نظافتها وشكلها عامل إزاي. دي أحادية الاستخدام، تم استخدامها مرة وتم تنظيفها وتطهيرها وتعقيمها، وبعدين فتحنا الآلة بعد التنظيف والتطهير والتعقيم لقينا هذا المنظر في الداخل. طيب إيه اللي حصل؟ اللي حصل إن عملية التنظيف بتاعتك لم تصل إلى الجروفز والبيرس اللي موجودة دي، الحفر ديت التنظيف ما وصلهاش، وبالتالي التعقيم أيضا لم يصلها بحسب القاعدة اللي قلناها من شوية. I will explain by English, then continue. The single-use instrument have a difficult engineering structure, have grooves and passage and coiled. Okay? What is the problem? This issue will be complicate the stage of cleaning. The cleaning not done adequately. So, the sterilization also not done adequately. Some people believe when you put the instrument in the steam sterilization machine or plasma sterilization machine, the whole organism will be die. Never. you must clean the instrument to can kill the microorganism, the remnant microorganism. Okay, and this is example, this picture is example about single use instrument. After using, make a cleaning and sterilization, then open the instrument, all this dirty present in the groove of the instrument. Okay, clear? Next. Next is Abdullah. This. Reasons of reprocess. This title, I need to, weak reasons. دي أسباب الناس, في بعض الناس اللي بتدعو إلى reuse of single use, عندها أسباب. طب هل الأسباب بتاعتهم منطقية؟ طب خلينا نطلع كده ونشوف هل أسبابهم دي منطقية؟ هل أسبابهم دي تجعلنا نمشي وراهم أو نوافق على طلبهم؟ خلينا نشوف. طبعا أهم سبب هما بيدعوا إليه وبيلفوا حواليه هو الكوست إفكتيف, توفير البادجت أو المال. طيب خليك معايا في موضوع التوفير, خلينا ناخدها بشكل عقلاني. بس أنا دلوقتي هوفر فلوس أكيد, لما اعمل reuse of single use انا هوفر فلوس, ده اكيد صح. جميل. طيب الكومبليكيشن او الادفيرز ايفنت اللي ممكن تحصل للمريض نتيجه هذا الريوز اوف سنجل يوز هيكلفك قد ايه؟ لو مات المريض هيكلفك قد ايه؟ حياه انسان ده حاجه عاديه عشان توفر مبلغ من المال بطريقه خاطئه. طب ما انت ممكن توفر احسن لو عالجته بشكل صحيح بآلة صحيحة دون أن تعرضه للخطر. يبقى إذن نقدر نرد على موضوع الكوست إفكتيف؟ آه طبعا نقدر نرد. طيب بعض الناس هتقول لي والله ده في أسباب تانية زي الفيري رير ريسورسز فور سام إكويبمنت, يعني بعض الآلات تصنيعها أصلا قليل وبالتالي ما فيش قدامنا حل غير إن إحنا نعمل لها ريوز. كويس. طيب الآلات اللي حضرتك بتتكلم عنها دي لما بتعمل لها ريوز هل تضمن إن طبيعتها الكيميائية وطبيعتها من التركيب لم يحدث فيها تغيير؟ إذا أنت تضمن هذا الكلام أوكي, لكن أنت لا تستطيع أن تضمن إلا بوجود ثيرد بارتي, إلا بوجود تقييم من منظمة الغذاء والدواء. طيب هذا الكلام ما هو موجود, يبقى إذن أنت لا تضمن. يبقى إذن أنت بتعمل ريسك وبتعمل خطر مش بتحل مشكلة, بالعكس أنت بتصنع أزمة مش بتحل مشكلة. خلاص. طيب طبعا بعض الزملاء الجراحين عندهم الموضوع ده كبير جدا, يقول لك انا عايز اقضي على الويتنج ليست. طيب لما تيجي تساله الويتنج ليست دي العمليات مثلا ايرجنت, تكتشف في الاخر انها عمليات مش ايرجنت, كلها عمليات الكتيف يمكن تاجيلها لحين توفير الالات, وفي الغالب هيتم توفير الالات, فممكن انك انت تاجل هذا الموضوع لحين توفير الالات. دي من ضمن الحجج. الحجه بقى اللي هي الكبرى اللي بتضحك, يعني يقول لك عشان نقلل الميديكال ويست, نقلل السايز بتاع الميديكال ويست, وبالتالي برضو نعمل كوست افكتيف. وكل ما نقلل الميديكال ويست ده شيء بيعمل لنا كوست افكتيف. انت عايز تقلل الميديكال ويست على حساب صحة المرضى وضمان حياتهم؟ لا, احنا اتفقنا ان تقديم الخدمة مهم ولكن under umbrella of patient safety, لازم تكون مقدم الخدمة تحت غطاء حماية المريض عشان تصل الى التارجت اللي انت عايز توصله. Okay, this is some weak reasons for reuse of single use, and each point can be discussed with the people. Number one, the cost effective. Ask them, what about the cost effective when the patient die, when the patient have adverse event? Okay, and the second one, some equipment is very rare sources. You can wait until this instrument arrive, and you must be ensure this equipment is safe or not. You cannot be ensure without third party. And until now, we don't have third party. Okay. Decrease the medical waste weight. This is weak point and not important. In US, some people say not documented, not good paper, but some people say 20-30% of hospital save the cost effect, but the adverse event is more costly than this percent. Okay, ديت اسباب الضعيفه وضحنا دلوقتي الاسباب الضعيفه اللي بيدعو فيها بعض الناس للريوز اوف سنجل يوز. نيكست يا استاذ عبد الله، نيكست سلايد بليز. وي ماست انسر ذيس كويشن اف وي نيد تو سنجل يوز ديفايس. ذا هيلث كير اورجانيزيشن WHO اسك سم كويشن تو بيبل نيد تو ريوز ذا سنجل يوز. نمبر 1، وات از ذا افكت اوف كليننج اند ستيرلايزيشن اون ذا فانكشن اوف ذا ديفايس. Sure, the function will be changed after exposed the instrument to chemical substance and high temperature steam sterilization and plasma sterilization. Okay. Also, this point is very important. How can the reprocessors confirm the reprocessing has not changed the device function or performance? I cannot. I am a physician. I am a nurse. I am a technician. I cannot confirm this point. I need engineering and chemical specialist to can ensure this point. Okay. أنا ما أقدرش كطبيب أو كممرض أو technician إن أنا أقدر أقول إن الآلة دي ما حصلهاش تغير في 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 الطبيعة الكيميائية. أنا عايز واحد كيميائي وعايز واحد مهندس. قلت لكم طبعا إن ده شيء مستحيل. Next. هنا في الامبليكيشن انا كل امبليكيشن معاده، يعني الامبليكيشن كلها معاده عن تاثير الريبروسيسنج على الاله وتغير طبيعه الاله وكل ده، كل دي المشاكل اللي هي الناتجه عن الريوز اوف سينج. لكن انا هسال سؤال مهم جدا جدا، ودي اهم نقطه موجوده في الدبليو اتش او. قالت نقطه مهمه جدا، لو مريض دخل يعمل عمليه معقده والعمليه دي حصل منها كومبليكيشن والعمليه دي تم عملها باله سنجل يوز، تم عملها باله سنجل يوز، السؤال هل هذه الكومبليكيشن ناتجه عن مال براكتس من التيم اللي عمل العمليه ولا ناتجه عن الاله اللي انت استخدمتها؟ من الصعب انك تحدد. طيب اغلب الفيزيشن اللي بيدعو الى ريوز اوف سنجل يوز لما بتحصل عنده فيلير في العمليه او مشكله سواء ديورنج اوبريشن او افتر اوبريشن، اي كومبليكيشن بيروح يرميها على ايه؟ على التعقيم. ولو معانا زملاء من قسم التعقيم هيحكوا لنا كثير من هذه الحكاوي، خصوصا لما بيتم الريوز اوف سنجل يوز. يبقى اذا هو ممكن يقابلك الاول الطبيب يقول لك احنا محتاجين ولازم نعمل العمليه وحياه المريض وما ادري وش، بعدين لما يحصل كومبليكيشن يبدا يقول لك ده انت السبب في الكومبليكيشن، الاله اللي انا استخدمتها وطريقه التعقيم هي السبب. وقد يكون هذا ليس صحيح. طب تقدر تثبت ده او تنفيه؟ لا تستطيع. فدي واحده من المشاكل الكبيره جدا المترتبه على الريوز اوف سنجل يوز. تمام. انا طبعا حاولت قدر المستطاع ان انا اوضح لكم الصوره بشكل كامل. وعندي مسج اخيره قبل ما انتهي، انا بقى لي دقيقتين بالظبط قبل ما انتهي من الديسكشن بتاعي. عندي مسج مهمه جدا هقولها بالعربي وهقولها بالانجليش. ارجو من كل الزملاء اللي بيشتغلوا في مجال مكافحه العدوى وحتى في المجالات الاخرى من الجراحه وغيره أن يتجنبوا هذه المشكلة، لأن لازم تسأل نفسك سؤال مهم: هل تتحمل مسؤولية أن تعيد استخدام آلة بدون قواعد صحيحة لمريض ومن ثم تحدث مضاعفات؟ إذا عرفت تجاوب على السؤال ده، إذا قلت أنا مسؤول عن ذلك، إذن فتوكل على الله. وأنا لا أعتقد أبداً أن في حد ممكن يرد على هذا السؤال. هقول بس المسج بالإنجليش واختم الاسئله، وبعدين في اخر اللقاء ان شاء الله نبدا نعمل open discussion عن هذا الامر. The last message after end of my lecture: please all staff must be refuse the reuse of single use until the national MOH and FDA make a legal issue and special recommendation for this issue. Okay? Because you cannot take a responsibility of reuse of single use if the adverse event will be done. Okay? شكرا لكم جميعا، وأرجو أن أنا أكون وصلت الرسالة للناس، وشاكر جدا للإدارة العامة لمكافحة العدوى على إتاحة هذه الفرصة. تفضل دكتور أحمد.
شكرا لك دكتور عبد الرحمن for this valuable and informative lecture. Second lecture, inshallah, will be overview of international regulation regarding reprocessing of single-use device. Dr. Nidal Tashpandi, infection preventionist, Infection Prevention and Control Administration, Jeddah Region, Bachelor Degree in Medicine and Surgery, JCI Diploma in Infection Control. Welcome, Dr. Nidal. Now you can share your presentation.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Good morning, everybody. أحب في البداية أشكر الإدارة العامة لمكافحة عدوى المنشآت الصحية وبالأخص برنامج التدريب في الإدارة العامة الدكتورة حنان حتحوت، الأستاذ عبد الله معدي، الأستاذ أحلام العمري والأستاذ هند العنزي. Today I will talk about international regulations for reprocessing of single-use devices. The objectives will be, I will talk about the international references starting with the World Health Organization, Food and Drug Administration, Joint Commission International, CDC, Medicine and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency in UK, International Society of Infectious Diseases, and some published research from other countries. As you all know, in 1860, Louis Pasteur and Joseph Lister, they started the modern reprocessing or sterilization of instruments. In 1950s, the medical industrial revolution happened there with so many instruments. In 1970s, single-use devices or the plastic revolution has started, which made more instruments but harder to reprocess or not to reprocess. 20 to 30% of US hospitals are reusing single-use devices, but I will say it in different way that 70 to 80% of US hospitals, they are not reusing single-use devices. Next, please. These are some samples of the single-use instruments. For war, these are the instruments, as you see, and Dr. Abdurrahman explained. Most of these instruments are made of plastic or rubber, cylindrical tubes, which is so hard to reprocess and very delicate. Most of them are heat sensitive. Next, please. World Health Organization in 2008 estimated that unsafe injection practices resulted in 340,000 HIV infections, 15 million hepatitis B infections, around 1 million hepatitis C infections, and 850,000 injection site abscesses worldwide. And all of these are related to reuse of single-use devices. Some concerns about the reuse of single-use devices were raised by the World Health Organization, especially for the device and the facility. Regarding the device, the devices are complex, which may not allow thorough decontamination as tubes or burrs. Testing for these reprocessings are not or cannot be performed. The material of most of these devices are delicate, heat sensitive, and cannot stand high temperature, might be corroded or absorb some chemicals which might leach gradually. Regarding the facility, as you know, World Health Organization, they are concerned about developed and developing countries. So the facilities in developing countries, they don't have that much in quality control, especially to control or just detect the decontamination process properly. Infection control also has to do tracking for the device and the patients to monitor and report any adverse effects from these reprocessing of such devices. Next. The quality assurance of reprocessing single-use devices by third party include all of these followings. Good manufacturing practice, and this will be by checking or taking the responsibility from the third party. Maintenance of device functionality and integrity. Proof of sterility or high level disinfection, which will take some quality test, including but not limited to the physical, chemical, and also biological indicators, testing for pyrogens, which are produced by the gram-negative bacteria, tracking and labeling these devices, which will be based on FDA as the WHO stated, and the device also with the patient by clear system, either manual or systematic for tracking those devices and patients. Recall of improperly reprocessed medical devices, which should be done by a good policy, strong tracking system. Failure in tracking will fail the ability of recall. Reporting of any adverse events, such infections or adverse effects due to the function of the reprocessed device. Quality control of each process as cleaning, disinfection, and sterilization with a specified policy for each device should be documented. Next, please. World Health Organization, they concluded or recommended that reusing of single-use devices carries obvious risk of cross-patient infection. Also, the increased probability of malfunction due to adverse effects of reprocessing on materials or delicate components. Next. For the FDA, FDA was mainly concerned about the regulation of the device itself more than the patient safety, mainly for the labeling and specifications of these devices. In August 2000, they released the guidance for the hospital or third party, as they will be considered as a manufacturer. Each hospital or third party should apply for a pre-market approval, as that device will be treated as a new device, and also they have to submit to sell or use these devices by the submission form. The labeling, and they were so concerned about this labeling, name and place of the manufacturer should be posted clearly. The label should be on the immediate container of the device. The common name of the device should be posted also clearly. Quantity of contents, if there is more than one device in the pack. Directions for use, and these directions should be specific for prescription device or over-counter devices. The language in English, except for exported or the ones used in Puerto Rico. Warnings from the side effects or the use. Adequate prominence, as it should be labeled clearly in font and appearance. Next, please. This is a sample of the labeling requirements. And if you see or notice, all these red are just the conditions for labeling. Anyone who will not label properly, they will not apply or they will not approve for reusing the reprocessed instruments. Next, please. Now we will talk about the Joint Commission International, and they had some significant, as they say, significant risk on patient safety. They were not concerned about the device itself or the standards of the devices. Inadequate cleaning for such devices might occur. Compromised performance after reprocessing was also an issue for the JCI. The standard of prevention and control of infection, 7.1, it stated that if single use of medical devices are reused in the hospital, a hospital policy must be created which guides such reuse when national laws or regulations exist. The policy must be consistent with these as well as professional standards. So if our regulation or laws in Saudi Arabia will not allow or prohibiting the reuse of single use, so all the hospitals in Saudi Arabia should not reuse those instruments. If you have that policy or the regulation will allow you to reuse single-use devices, a policy should be made for each device, and the manufacturer will not be liable for the device if it has been used as the manufacturer instructions. The policy should be compliant with the country laws and professional regulation. Device and identification should be individualized for each device with the directions of use and the name of that device. A protocol for cleaning and disinfection and sterilization also should be specified for each device. Adverse outcomes or failure should be monitored and documented. And I will talk about that because also it is related to the quality and patient safety policy of the JCI. Patient and device tracing or tracking should be done properly and documented. Also, analysis and improvement should be done as a performance improvement project. Lastly, the Joint Commission stated or concluded that the decision of reusing single-use devices is complex, not easy to decide, and will take the responsibility the hospital who will approve that, but should follow the national law and regulations again. The hospital must advocate for practices in the best interest of patient, which is the main objective and determinant. They should share it also with the patient. Each patient should know if you are going to use a single-use or reprocess single-use device, and you have to take the approval or consent from that patient. Now we'll move to the UK, and this is the Medicine and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency. They said that there is a potential for cross-infection, and it is the greatest risk. Inability to clean and decontaminate, as this process should be validated with indicators. Residues from chemical decontamination agents, as some materials can absorb or adsorb certain chemicals, which can gradually leach over time from that device. Material alteration with exposure to some chemicals or high temperature, corrosion might happen and alteration might occur. Mechanical failure of those devices also, you might express a physical stress on those instruments. Reaction to endotoxins, which are not inactivated by the sterilization process. MHRA, they stated that some single-use devices can be remanufactured by the company, who then relabels and certifies its performance as if it were a new device, and it is then purchased by a user in the knowledge that this it is remanufactured. So the responsibility will be transferred from the original manufacturer to the reprocessor or third-party processor. Organizations, professionals, users, and reprocessors who prepare single-use devices for further episodes of use may be transferring also the legal liability of the product from the manufacturer to themselves or the organization that employs them. And they will take the full responsibility of that device and its outcomes. Some of the outcomes or this one. So they might be liable to health and safety at work if they expose the patient or staff to risk. They may contravene the provisions relating to general duties and exposure to patients or staff to risk. Part one of consumer protection as a civil liability. Payment for any damages for any injury caused to another person by the device. General product regulations. When the device is intended, consumers are likely to be used by consumer or also the producer or the distributor. UK medical devices regulation, essential requirements covering the safety and performance of those medical devices. So I think no one will take the responsibility of those four acts. This is from the International Society for Infectious Diseases. There is relationship between the complexity of the device and the difficulty of reprocessing it. You should state a clear limit for number of reuse. You should also know any unknown burden complications on healthcare workers and patients. As you increase the exposure of healthcare workers to body fluids, chemicals used for sterilization or reprocessing, all patients who will be used those devices, they should be informed and approved for that reuse. The risks of infection or malfunction. Infection might happen due to improper reprocessing, pyrogenic reaction also, as we mentioned, and was a main concern for all the references, due to endotoxins or pyrogenic reactions, toxicity as a chemical from the device itself or the disinfectants. Now we have also a new risk, which is the trace of plastics or particulate contamination, integrity breakage due to intolerance of that device. Soman et al. In 2015, he reported on 5 cases of infective endocarditis with rapidly growing mycobacterium in patients who were known to have had intravascular stent replacement, which involved reprocessed percutaneous transluminal angioplasty balloon catheters. And that was really a high risk study for those patients. Next. We had also another study, reuse of medical devices implications for infection control. Emily Schaumann stated in 2012 that the reuse of single-use devices can be problematic. Single-use devices are commonly reused, but the reuse of medical devices raises important legal and ethical issue regarding the adverse outcomes, which are very limited. And the debate was about to reuse or not to reuse. Wilbel Green in 2015, she also published the reuse of disposable medical devices. And her debate was about, is it economical or safety? Since the plastic revolution, the disposable started to displace the reusable. The claim was economical innovation that became a significant cost in the budget. The practice is spreading and the debate is going on because also they found reprocessing single-use device is not that cheap. Next. The last study, Michelle Alpha published in 2004 at EJIC, the effect of the guidance of FDA, which was stated in 2000, on 48 hospitals in Michigan, which had more than 200 beds. He found that the on-site reprocessing at these hospitals has dropped from 46 to 21% after this guidance. The third party raised almost the double from 17% to 35%, and the no reprocessing raised from 37% to 44% in those hospitals, as they couldn't reprocess according to the FDA regulations. I think everyone or healthcare provider should have the balance between the patient's safety and other factors like the economical, environmental, or even the supply of chain. But the main concern for everyone, and I think it is the aim, is the patient's safety. So I hope that you consider that factor. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Dr. Nidal, for this informative lecture that gives us overview about international regulation for reprocessing of single-use device. Now we reach the end of the first session. We will have a break for 15 minutes, but please, everyone should register through the link. We will present it now on the chat. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back again. Now this is the time of the next lecture. National regulation regarding prohibiting reprocessing of single-use device. Ms. Ahlam El-Omari, senior specialist, primary healthcare nursing, master of primary healthcare nursing, Australia, diploma in infection control in healthcare training college, UK. Welcome, Ms. Ahlam. Now you can present.
Assalamu alaikum jamian. Good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank my colleagues, Dr. Abdulrahman and Dr. Nidal, the senior expert in the infection control field, for their comprehensive session in regard covering all the aspects and the criteria and approaches that required for the reprocessing or reusing of single-use devices. And they explained completely. They cover all the aspects in regard to this debate or significant issues that we are encountered nowadays in the healthcare facilities. So first of all, this lecture or this session, it will be about the national regulation regarding the prohibiting and avoiding reprocessing or reusing of single-use devices. And we have a specific outlines that we will cover in this session, inshallah. Main thing is to explore the known facts that documented or reported in the studies regarding the implication of reusing of single-use devices, and also to identify the national measures and standards regarding prohibiting reprocessing or reusing of single-use devices. And finally, we'll determine the advocate or advocacy approaches that require to support the national recommendations and regulation regarding prohibiting of reuse or reprocessing of single-use devices. So, as we all know that the reuse or reprocess of the single-use devices involve many applications, include regulatory, ethical, legal, and economic impacts and implications, and has been extremely controversial debate or argument for more than 2 decades. So the key issues that we will talk about, or we are focusing for the whole webinar session today, is about the reutilization or reprocessing of single-use devices. Although they are in our country at national level, we don't have a well-founded practice or regulations regarding reprocessing and reutilization, and we have a clear memos and standards for prohibiting this practice. Still, we are facing the same issues and we are encountering the same malpractice in the healthcare facility, which is lead to poor quality and safety care provided to our patients. So as we all know that we have a specific known facts. So known facts already reported in the studies and the international reference that the reuse and reutilization of the single-use devices lead to the infections and malfunctions, which is lead to the higher risk to the our patients, and which is all caused by the re-sterilization process for the single-use devices. Biogenic reaction, toxicity, breakage integrity, and biocompatibility, risk for personnel, risk for the environment, risk for the patient itself, all these implications are considered and well reported in the studies. Many single-use devices are reused without being adequately evaluated. And it's already explained comprehensively in my colleague lectures that we have a major defect in the quality assurance and evaluations of the practice of reprocessing of single-use devices, which is lead to risk, a significant risk to our patients. And also it's reported in the studies that a clear definition of the single-use devices that designated only for single-use procedure for the single patient at single time and must be discarded safely at the same time. So it's a clear definition about the single-use devices. So we cannot encounter or preach this definition. Also, it's a known fact in the studies and research that exposing a patient and the staff to unnecessary risk is a one factor or risk factor that leads from the reprocessing or reusing of single-use devices. We don't have extensive testing, validations, quality assurance, and documentation to ensure this practice for safety for our patient. So we have to put in our mind and we have to highlight this spot regarding the legal implications. Anyone who reprocesses or reuses a device intended by the manufacturer as a single use must bear the full responsibility for its safety and effectiveness. As it's always mentioned that the legal implication and the responsibilities is imposed on the healthcare facility who is reprocessing or reusing of single-use devices. So we have many studies or research regarding the effectiveness and the bad consequences or negative outcomes of the reusing of or reutilization of single-use devices. And today we have a specific studies that cited in the significant references, for example, the US FDA in the GCI, the studies about prospective randomized single-blinded in vitro and ex vivo evaluation of new and reprocessed laparoscopic trocars. And this study is already published in the Journal of the American College of Surgeons, especially in the date of 2020 by Mew et al. And the study is about the main goal of this study to differentiate or evaluate the difference between the new devices and the reused single-use devices. And they're specific in the laparoscopic trocars in the laparoscopic procedure, surgical procedure. And they are evaluating a specific characteristic of these devices, which include the visual and the microscopic inspection, the force of the trocar insertion, the removal of the trocar itself, the seal leak rate determination, and testing of the blade shield speed. And they found that there is a significant major difference between the new single-use devices and the reused one. And they have a malfunction and malperfection in the reused single-use devices. So now, after the whole introduction that I introduced, that we have to focus in our regulation as a country, as a Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, we have a specific national regulation regard prohibiting the reusing of single-use devices, which is stated in the memorandum, also stated in the standards. We will explore it more in the next slides. So why reprocessing is not allowed or prohibited in our country? We have to ask ourselves why. And even Dr. Abdurrahman, he asked or cited this question in his session, and he waiting for you to answer this question in the discussion session. So as my colleagues introduced the specific criteria or approaches that required for reprocessing a single-use devices, I will repeat it again and again. So we don't have at the national level a specific third party responsible for reprocessing of single-use devices. And we all know in the infection control practice that the in-house reprocessing or sterilization is not allowed and prohibited. Also, the validation, the quality assurance, also it's not, we don't have a cornerstone process for this practice. The responsibility and authority, who is responsible for any side effect that will occur in our patient. The tracking and tracing of the side effects and negative consequences after the procedure of both the care of the patients. Who will trace that and who will be responsible for that? All these factors, we are it's concluded by our national regulation, and they are prohibiting the reusing or utilization of single-use devices based on that. So the national regulation, as I mentioned earlier, that they state the prohibiting of this practice through specific standards and memorandum. The first standard, as we all know, the infection control audit standards, it's an auditing tool that's used for auditing the infection control practices in the healthcare facilities. And there is a specific particular standard, 2020.1, the facility has implemented the policy for not reusing of single-use devices. And it's a critical standard that we are evaluating our healthcare facilities when we are auditing them for the infection control practice. So it's a clear standard that no reuse. So we don't want to argue about the third party or the in-house sterilization processes or the policy that states we can to reuse or reprocess, because it's already standard that mentioned or stated no reuse of single-use devices. Another Saudi Central Board of Accreditation of Healthcare Institutions, they are focusing also on the standards. So the standard itself, it's about the hospital ensured safe reprocessing of single-use items. So the hospital implements a policy and procedure regarding reprocessing of single-use devices, which define the following: the items that can be reused, patient and condition of reuse of single-use items, and measures taken to ensure safety and integrity, including testing, maintenance by my biomedical engineering. And you have to underline this with three lines. Yeah. Manufacturer approval. So we have to send a request to the manufacturer, original manufacturer, to take the approval for reprocessing or re-sterilization of the same single-use devices. So we faced that during our auditing, that we are receiving a question for this particular standards, why the Sibahi they are permitting. The Sibahi not permitting, the Sibahi they put a specific standards based on the international references and also based on the national references. And the national references, it's already state that no reuse of single-use devices. So remember that. We have a national regulation and legislation that prohibiting reusing of single-use devices. We don't have a third party in place, so we don't have the infrastructure for this practice. And maybe we'll have it in the future, but till date, we have to follow no reusing or no reprocessing of single-use devices. The quality assurance and validations, also the tracking and tracing, the side effect and negative consequences. Patient notification, are we notifying the patient that we are using single-use devices that reprocess for them? No, actually. And this is, it leads us to the ethical and legal implications. The responsibility, who is responsible for this practice? Malpractice, actually. Who is responsible to take the full responsibilities and bears the responsibility for any effects that will happen in our patient? So we have as infection control, and from this today webinar, that we have to work as a pioneer in infection control practice. We have to have a specific advocacy measures that support the national recommendation regarding the prohibiting the reuse of single-use devices. National decision-making is already constructed and stated through the Saudi Health Council from by the Minister of Health at 2016, and particularly the statement is at number 73/4. It stated that no reuse or reprocessing of single-use devices. We have a clear policy and standards that shows that must be reused a single-use devices, and it should be discarded immediately after single use on the single patient at the single procedure. Also, from this session, we start the education and training, and we hope that all of you, the pioneers in infection control practice, you will lead this issue and you will start the education and training campaign in your healthcare facilities regarding this issue and make the picture clear for everyone about the debate of the reusing of single-use devices. Also, we have to monitor the practice compliance. We should ensure that we are providing a safe and quality of care to our patients. And recently, we published a specific poster regarding the reusing of single-use devices, which is stated that no reuse of single-use devices. Again, I'd like to repeat the same slide of the legal implications that anyone who reprocesses or reuses the devices that intended by the manufacturer as a single-use devices bears the full responsibility for its safety and effectiveness. Always remember that the patients are coming to our hospital seeking a quality and safe care, so we have to give them that trust by providing a safe practice. So it's important to remember that patients coming to the hospital for care surrounded by the professional and trusted healthcare professionals. And the hospital must advocate for their patient and for the practice that provided for them and in the best interest for our patient. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you so much, Ms. Ahlam Al-Omari, for this excellent presentation and the clear message you give to us that nowadays no reprocessing of single-use item is allowed at national level at any circumstance. And if you do this, you are the one who responsible for safety of the patient. Now, this is the time for open discussion. If you have any question, please write in the chat. We already have some received question. First question we received: in case of shortage of single-use device, what are the accepted alternative or available option you recommend? Ms. Ahlam, ممكن حضرتك تردي على السؤال. Please respond to this question.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hanan. It's really interesting, and always we are these questions pop up, and we always receiving the same questions during our auditing or any lectures that we provided related to the single-use devices. Actually, as we all know, that every healthcare facility have a specific policy regarding the chain of supply, and the chain of supply should monitor a process of them tracking the bar level, also monitoring the supplies that provided, and also to ensure the documentation is provided and implemented in the healthcare facilities, and never ever reaching the zero level at any circumstances. So in case of shortage of single-use supplies and you are not implementing policy appropriately, you have all the healthcare facility have a specific authority to have a direct purchase and to avoid any shutdown any services. So in conclusion, no way to compensate the shortage of supply by reusing or reprocessing single-use devices, because the significant implications that we are provided in our lecture. Thank you so much for this question, Dr.
Thank you, Ms. Ahlam. Another question we have. Some international reference permit the reprocessing of single-use device. Why we don't allow this practice at the national level? Dr. Nidal, ممكن حضرتك ترد على السؤال. دكتور نضال حضرتك معانا.
ليه دكتورة؟
سلام دكتور نضال.
Some international references they permit the reprocessing of single-use devices, but they put very strict regulations to guarantee that these devices are safe for reuse. Another time on those patients, to ensure the sterility, safety, and functionality also of the reprocessed devices. These regulations are like clear regulations and legislation, approved third party, written policies regarding the single-use medical devices with list of the devices that can be reprocessed and how can be reprocessed, validation and quality assurance evaluation for each device and each process also. I think the main concern also about tracking of any adverse effects or injuries, tracking those devices and on which patients being used. So I don't think it's easy, and not all the references they are permitting the reuse of those devices.
شكرا دكتور نضال. Another question we have. Some item labeled as single use, such as N95 respirator. Why MOH permit the reuse of this item, although it is single used? دكتور عبد الرحمن ممكن حضرتك معانا في السؤال ده؟
السلام عليكم. Regarding the question from some item labeled as a single used, such as N95 respirator, why the MOH permit the reuse of this item? We have many causes regarding. الآن سامعيني كمان؟ Again, the causes.
أيوة تفضل دكتور عبد الرحمن.
The causes are, number one, this approval come after research regarding the safety of reuse by specific regulation. And after many researches study this issue. And the time of this availability during the worldwide pandemic and very rare resources regarding the N95 mask. And also I need to explain very important point regarding this issue. The mask is not invasive instrument, not device. It is a superficial covering the mouth, and all the dangers come from the outside of the patient, and use of this mask protect the healthcare worker from dangerous respiratory infection. So all these causes give the availability or a chance for allowing of reuse or extended use of N95 during the pandemic of COVID-19. Okay, this is the answer regarding this issue.
شكرا لك دكتور عبد الرحمن. Another question we have, in case of emergency or trauma emergency and we have zero stock from NIPCO, what should we do? Mr. Ahlam, I think cover this question, but may stress the answer.
Thank you, Dr. Hanan. As I mentioned in my session that each healthcare facility should have a chain of supply policy. And we don't want the title itself. We need to consider the process of that chain of supply. We have to monitor the supply, bar level should be documented, and never ever reaching the zero stock. Even during the pandemic, we are reaching only in the crisis situation. And we have a specific pathway for direct purchase. So no excuse for shutting down the procedure because of shortage of supply or zero stock. And the responsible authorities, they have the full responsibility regarding of shutting down that service. We are not talking about the title only. We have to monitor the practice and the compliance of that practice. Thank you so much.
شكراً أستاذ أحلام. We have other two questions related to Sibahi standard. First, Sibahi standard demonstrate safe reprocessing of single-use device. What are your recommendations? And another question in Arabic, نبلغ Sibahi أننا لا نعيد معالجة الأدوات أحادية الاستخدام. طيب, أستاذ أحلام, cover this question, please.
Okay, thank you again. Always, I don't know why, because always we are focusing on the taking the standard itself, and we are not going through the roots and details of that standard. Sibah is a well-recognized institution, but they are putting the details, and always the standard must be based on national and international references, and our national references and regulation prohibiting this practice. So it's supposed to be no reuse of single-use devices for any circumstances. Sorry again. So we cannot only focusing on the standard, and we are leaving the room. National and international references.
Thank you, Ms. Ahlam. We have another question or comment. So it is clear that in KSA, we don't have the option to reprocess single-use device. However, it is allowed and acceptable under regulation of FDA by involving third party. Dr. Nidal, your comment? So it's clear that in KSA, we don't have the option to reprocess single-use device. However, it's allowed and acceptable under the regulation of FDA by third party.
FDA has approved that, but with certain regulations, mainly about the labeling and approval and submission. I think it was not related to patient safety. So if we have any third party or a hospital can apply those regulations, it will be safe. But as Dr. Abdurrahman mentioned, it will be so hard for applying third party in the current situation.
Another question, thank you, Dr. Nidal. Another question, are we obligated to report to hospital that reinforce multiple use of single use item? Dr. Abdurrahman.
Thank you, Dr. Hanan. Sure, we must report any case of reuse without approval from the third party or from legal issue of the national Saudi Arabia. You must report this this issue to prevent the recurrent of reuse of single use.
Can expired item be used for like central line for life saving of the patient?
I believe regarding the expired instrument must be reviewed the manufacturer can be allowed or not, because sometimes the expired equipment may be cause the change in chemical criteria of the instrument, or a change in the eligibility and elasticity of the instrument. So we must review the manufacturer about this issue, if allow for some time after end or not. But usually this is not applicable.
Dr. Dahl, any comments?
Sometimes expired devices or materials might kill the patient and not save life.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Nadal. Another question, can MOH create a third party? Ms. Ahlam?
Okay, shukran, Doctora. I have a question. Yeah, we mentioned earlier in our session that we still up to date, we don't have any infrastructure for this practice. In the future, and through a multidisciplinary team from the Saudi FDA, from the Ministry of Health, from the Saudi CDC, also from the Health Council, Saudi Health Council. We will work as a multidisciplinary team, and we will establish a practice for reprocessing or utilization of single-use devices if applicable. But till date, no, we don't have any third party, and we have to follow the regulation, national regulation regarding of prohibiting of reusing and utilization of single-use devices. Thank you so much.
Another question, if single-use item is expired in store, but the bag is still intact, what's your recommendation? Dr. Abdul Rahman, Dr. Nidal, anyone can respond to this question?
This issue related to the medical store. And the medical store must be reviewed, the equipment and the date of end of equipment, and arrange this issue. But if this issue come to the infection preventionist, as before, as I explained before, you must ask the manufacturer about the uses of this instrument after end of expired date. And I believe this this problem must be discussed with the medical store.
دكتور حنان
طيب another question my question is about stainless steel cutter for example stainless steel cutter for example is it permissible for reuse or reprocess
according to the label of equipment دكتور حنان if the equipment is single use not be applicable to reusable. Even stainless steel, even and because some instrument maybe have a groove that, as discussed before, the design of equipment may be difficult to reprocess, difficult to cleaning. Okay. So according to the labeled of equipment, is the single use or not? If the single use, never reusable. Mrs.
Ahlam,
any
شكرا دكتور ما شاء الله كفيت ووفيت I will add only one comment that every tool or instrument have a shelf life as we all know so if it's expired or the manufacturer label it as a single use devices we have to follow that we cannot reprocess any single use devices because the national regulation is clear about this and because of the characteristic of the instrument itself it will be a mal function and mal perfection it will lead to significant hazard and risk to our patient safety. So please follow the manufacturer instruction regarding the label of the device and also regarding the expiration date and plus the shelf life.
Shukran, Ustaz Ahlam. Another question. As you know, most of the hospitals are reusing single-use tool. Are there any local study regarding this? And are they reporting it at national level in patient note or operative note for auditing and assessment?
Until now, Dr. Hanan, until now, we don't have national approval for reuse of any single-use substance. So if the hospital make this issue, and I will make a study regarding this issue, this is already, not follow the law of the national law. This is false. I cannot make a study about false issue. Okay? If the FDA and MOH and other agents in the Saudi Arabia make legal point regarding the reuse of single use, after that I can make study to follow the adverse event or not like this. Okay, but now it is not allowed.
Thank you, Dr. Abdul Rahman. Thank you, Dr. Nidal. Thank you, Ms. Ahlam. في النهاية أود أشكر الجميع حضورهم وتفاعلهم. أتمنى إن شاء الله نكون وصلنا الرسالة واضحة. استطعنا الإجابة على تساؤلاتكم واستفساراتكم. في النهاية أشكر سعادة الدكتور خالد العنزي مدير الإدارة العامة لمكافحة عدوى المنشآت الصحية ومدير البرنامج لتوجيهاته لإطلاق هذا البرنامج لتوضيح المفاهيم الأساسية والتنظيمات العالمية والوطنية فيما يخص إعادة معالجة الآلات والأدوات حديث الاستخدام شكرا للجميع وألقاكم على خير في لقاءات قادمة إن شاء الله. أتمنى من الجميع المشاركة في الاستبيان الخاص بتقييم البرنامج. I would like to thank you all for your participation and attendance, and I hope that we will give you a clear message and answer all of your questions. I would like to thank you, Dr. Khalid Al-Ainazi, General Directorate of Infection Prevention and Control and Program Organizer. Please, everyone should use the barcode and evaluate the program. I wish you a good day and see you later, inshallah. Thank you all.